16th of April is Resurrection Sunday. That week beforehand, we'll be doing, God willing, some meetings we'll be having on Wednesday night, Thursday night, and the Friday night. Friday night will be a communion service as well. We'll be focusing in on that kind of what they call the Passion Week, the last week of Jesus. In fact, if you may not know this, but you know, out of the 90 chapters that we have recorded for us about the life of Jesus in the Gospels, that's 89 of them that are in the Gospels, and then one is the beginning of the book of Acts is there. So that's 90 chapters that you have. 55 of those chapters are about that last week. So out of all that God gave us, particularly about the life of Jesus, more than half of it is about that last week. Do you think God might be emphasizing something for us? Yeah? So if he's going to emphasize it, don't you think it'd be wise if we did too? And so that's what we want to do. We're going to take some time and walk through some of those things when it comes to that last week. And then we're going to have, God willing, on Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, and we'll have our normal meetings there. But it's a good time to invite, and if you're thinking about coming and joining us, please feel free. Also, there's a couple of things in the back, those leaflets. There's one on Palm Sunday to Easter or the Resurrection Sunday, and it kind of goes through the last week of Jesus. It's a good one to take a look at. And this one on evidences of the resurrection. So it might just be worth taking some time. And if you don't want to get it, just pick it up, read it, and then put it back. It's fine. It's no big deal. But to be able to familiarize yourself, because often during these times, people ask a lot of questions about the cross, about what happened, how do you know it's real? And both from your own life and from history, we can help them to understand that these things aren't just far-fetched stories, they're realities and truths and historical events that have taken place. We want to begin tonight in looking at a parable in Matthew's gospel. We have a number of these parables that are given to us about what the kingdom of God is like. And so in Matthew 13, we have a very particular one. In verse 24, we find that Jesus speaking about the kingdom. He says, another parable he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares also appeared. So the servants of the owner came to him and said, sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have tares? And he said to them, an enemy has done this. Their servant said to him, do you want us then to go and gather them up? But he said, no, lest while you gather up the tares, you also uproot the wheat with them. But let both grow until the harvest. And at the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather together the tares and bind them in bundles and burn them, and then gather the wheat into my barn. Jesus then gives an explanation of this particular parable. We remember that parables were given very particularly. In fact, Jesus said then further on in verse 34, he says, all these things Jesus spoke to the multitude in parables, and without a parable, he did not speak to them, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables, and I will utter things kept secret from the foundations of the world. Elsewhere, he says that the reason parables were used is so that it would actually hide things from those that were arrogant and proud and learned, and would reveal these things, as it were, to babes, so that it was God who opened people's eyes, like we're looking at this morning with Lydia. God opened her heart, and God does this work. Here Jesus explains the parable.
Then Jesus sent the multitudes away and went into the house, and his disciples came to him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the tares of the field." And he answered and said to them, "He who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed are the sons of the kingdom, but the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. And there will be weeping, wailing, pardon me, and gnashing of teeth. And the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." It's quite a sobering parable, really. And for us that belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, I want to take us through a few things, and then I want to bring kind of some questions, kind of some comparisons, because sometimes in situations, well, even in church, if you want to call it that way, there are those that come in, and because all we can see is the outward appearance, and people will say, "Oh, well, I'm Christian too." But really, they're tares. See, one of the things that we don't often realize is that a tare and a wheat look really similar. But one is deadly poison and the other one is food to have. They look similar. But the inside of them is poison. But you and I can't see the inside, can we? And so in the world, that is, and even within what they call the visible church, the church is God's people, those that are born again of the Spirit, those that belong to Christ. Jesus said, "I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Jesus is building it. And the Father, by his Spirit, is revealing things, and people come to faith. And like Lydia this morning, she became part of God's people, the church, because now she was in Christ. Whether Jew or Gentile, all become unified in him. He's the foundation of it. He's the cornerstone of it. He's the capstone of it. And in the world, then you find they're even in the visible church, and that's everyone who would come, and you see them. And in the midst of them, there are those that have genuinely believed. There are those who have really come to faith, and there are those that are pretending to be what they're not. And that can be quite disturbing. I mean, on the way in this evening, I was driving down the road, and as I'm watching and looking at certain people as I'm driving, and I'm thinking about some of our young people that come to Jam, and some of them having professed the desire to come to church on a Sunday to be more involved. Some of them even saying they wanted to get baptized because they themselves, and this was out of their own mouth, had believed in the Lord Jesus. But then others said, "No." Whew. How dangerous that is. How evil and wicked. Those are tares. Sons of the wicked one, it actually says. That's quite severe. But outwardly, they can look okay, but inwardly, it's poison. See, let's go back for a moment. We've been looking at some of this even in the ladies' Bible study, that when it comes to what God is doing and what God has done and how it proceeds, in the very beginning, God made man in his image. He made man in his image and glory. He made them male and female. And God glorified himself. He told them to be what? Fruitful and multiply. Yeah? Now, he's not just talking about having a family. That's not what he's talking about there, although that's the kind of way it's worked out. Open your Bibles to Genesis real quick. Let me just show you a couple of things here to help us get an understanding of this. And I believe things will be made clear for us. See, reproduction is something that God designed in his creation. Look at verse 11 of Genesis 1. Genesis 1, verse 11. Then God said, let the earth bring forth grass and the herbs that yield seed and the fruit tree that yields fruit according to its kind. According to its kind. Verse 12. What happens there? And the earth brought forth seed and grass, herb that yields seed according to its. So the tree, the herbs that has, and then the seed that's produced produces the same thing that's produced in the original. It's reproduction according to its kind. That principle is a spiritual one, not just a natural one. Kind produces kind all the time. Be clear. Kind always produces kind. Dogs produce kittens, right? No, that's silly. Why? Because dogs produce dogs. Cats produce birds. No, that's silly. Cats produce cats because they're feline kind. It's a kind according to their own kind. Even when it comes to grass and trees and herbs, they're produced according to their kind. There's different genres of them. But this is a spiritual principle. Verse 21. I'm just showing you just kind of repetitively that this is an important one. God keeps bringing this out. So God created great sea creatures and every living thing that moves, with which the waters abounded. Now, some of those sea creatures that we've discovered dinosaur-wise are just awesome. They're huge. With the megalosaurus, that's like this huge, the megalodon, which is this huge shark kind of thing, which it didn't seem to have any equal. Massive things. But even them, with which the waters abounded according to their kind. Kind produces kind. So when one genre died out, it no longer produced that which was according to its kind. We call it what? Being extinct, don't we? So there was nothing more that came after that. Why? Because it didn't evolve. It was produced according to its own kind. So it didn't evolve and become something different. There's interbreeding between them. We know how that works with dogs and flowers. We learned that in biology. But they're still according to their own kind. But kind always produces kind. Always. This is important for us to understand. Because when we look at the parable, it'll begin to make more sense. Kind produces kind. How about in verse 24, we'll finish up. I think I've made the point that kind produces kind. But then God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to its kind, cattle and creeping things and beasts of the earth, each according to its kind. Kind produces kind. This is important. Because now when you look at when God said, let man come forth, or he doesn't, he said that he's made man, pardon me, in his image and in his glory. So then the design of God was that kind would produce kind. You know, Adam was called a son of God. Why? Because kind was producing kind. God the Father was forming Adam in his own image. God was producing after his own kind. Not gods, hear me, not gods. That's a foreign teaching. That's a false concept. But what you have is that he's making man after his own image and glory. He's reproducing, as it were, in himself, in man. He breathes into him and he becomes a living soul. And so now Adam shares in the character of God. Adam shares in the glory and the grace of God. He's sharing in qualities that God shares with his creation, but very particularly manifested in him. And God puts his spirit in him and he becomes a living being. is different from the animals. God just said, let them come up. And he says to Adam, he says, I'm going to form. And he does. He forms him and then specifically breathes into him. They call it the breath of life even today, don't they? It's something very, really, it's quite intimate. And God brings forth life in Adam. And he, kind is now producing what? Kind. Now he says, be fruitful and multiply. What is God looking for? He's not looking for just a bunch of people to be running around, but that in God's creation, Adam having been made in the image and the glory of God, now what's going to cover the earth? The image and the glory of God. So God's making that Adam would reproduce according to that image, and that the glory of God would cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. That the earth would be filled with the glory of God. Now, man fell and sin came in. Man died in his relationship with God and became corrupted and perverted. But there's still something of that glory that's in there because God still made man in his image. That's why we see some of the amazing things people can do and are. Unfortunately, often the motivation for doing those things is quite twisted. Often for self-glorification rather than the glorification of God. Now, just to show you how this works, look at Genesis chapter 5. We'll begin with, verse 1 there. This is the book of the genealogy of Adam. In the day that God created man, he made him in his in the likeness of God. He created them male and female and blessed them and called them mankind in the day that they were created. And Adam lived 130 years and begot a son in what? Not God's likeness, in his own likeness. And you'll notice the name of this lad is what? Seth. Whoa, hang on now. Didn't he already have two other babies that are named Cain and Abel? Oh, my. Well, what happened with Cain? He murdered his brother, so now Abel's no more. Cain, having become a murderer, God's put a sign, a symbol on him, and sent him off away. So he's actually just removed from the genealogy. Now, another one is Seth, and Seth is also in Adam's image, Adam's nature, death and sin and the corruption and, oh. Now, how did Adam and Eve get that way? Well, the Bible tells me that Eve was what? Deceived. By who? Oh. And in his fallen state, what did he want to do? Reproduce his own character in man. You can too be like God. What did he want to do? Be like God. Be above the throne of God. Live independent of God. And what did he try to reproduce then, or wanted to reproduce in her and in him, the same qualities that he has, and they become sons of the devil, sons of the wicked one. Kind produces kind. Always happens, always will. Even in our influence, don't we? We want to share with people what we've done so that they do the same things that we do, so that we are reproducing in them what's in us. Interesting, huh? It's a principle that's always there. When we give advice and we're doing that, we're reproducing what's in us and others. If we're speaking truth, it's producing something in them. If we're speaking lies and fables and old wives' tales and those kinds of things, what is it reproducing? Kind always reproduces kind. Always. So God made us in his image, and he made us to reproduce his glory, but Satan came in and reproduced in Adam what was in him. So then you have this situation where God has his people, and he's going to reproduce things in his own, and now the enemy is also reproducing his own image in others. Now look at the parable. Sons of the what? Wicked one. Sons of the kingdom. Two different groups of people. And that's all the world is divided into. That's it. You're one or the other. Right now, right here, where you're sitting, you belong to one or the other. That's it. There is no middle ground. There is, well, I'm kind of half and half. It doesn't work that way. You don't half wheat, half tear. Kind produces kind. So Jesus comes into the world. God's setting up a kingdom. He's advancing it. He's having called out a people to himself to separate them unto himself. But he's having to do something more than that, because the work that has to go inside, he has to reproduce in a different capacity than just having laws and rules on the outside that people try to obey. So he has to reproduce in them. That's why Jesus said, you must be born again, born from above. So John chapter 1, verse 13, Doug will bring that up for us. Verse 12, but as many as received him, that's receiving Jesus, because he was in the world and even his own didn't receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave power to become what? Kind produces kind. What is he doing? Jesus now is reproducing his life in the lives of God's people, his children, and they're born. They're born anew. If any man is in Christ, he becomes a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. He's reproducing his likeness in them. Ones who were born not of blood, not of the will of the flesh. It's not genealogy. It's not by effort and desire. It's not even by a man's decision and will or effort, but they're born of God. He's reproducing now in man exactly what's in Christ. So Jesus then is the one. He's the fullness of God made man. He's what Adam should have been. And then in those who come to have faith in him, those who trust in him, these are the sons of the kingdom. These are the ones now when Jesus is placing his life in them. They have life to the full. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That nature is reproduced in the sons of the enemy, of the evil one, and their same character is produced there. But the character of Christ is reproduced in his own. Why? Because they're born of him. And kind is producing kind. Do you see how this works? See, now you begin to see then the difference between the sons of the wicked one and the sons of the kingdom. Because those who walk in righteousness, those who walk in love, those who walk in the footsteps of Jesus, now what are you beginning to see? The character of Jesus made manifest. Because kind produces kind. So then Jesus would say it this way, by their fruits, you will know them. Why? Because the kind produces kind. The seed of the gospel has gone down in deep into them, and they've been transformed by it, and now are producing the fruit of the kingdom. They produce the character of the Spirit of God indwelling them, so that there's love and joy and peace and patience, kindness. They walk in righteousness, they walk in light, they walk in love, and they're pursuing those things. They seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's very different. It's no longer church, is it? It's no longer who sings loud enough and who's there every service. There's something in them that's changed. Kind is producing kind. They're born again. Jesus said, you must be born again. So what is it that this image is? Well, Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3, where it speaks of Jesus. It speaks of Jesus being that expressed image of God. He's in human. He's in human form. Remember, he's both God and man. He doesn't cease to be either. He's fully God. But when he's walking it out in the world, he's walking it out as man. He's living it out as man. Why? Because an eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. He was born under the law, born of a woman, born under the law, that he can redeem those who were under the law. Because he has to come as man to fulfill what Adam failed to do so that he can redeem us. Because he doesn't come as God to fulfill all righteousness. He comes as man to fulfill all righteousness. We don't deny the humanity of Jesus, nor do we deny the deity of Jesus, because he was the one who came down from heaven. He's the fullness of the God made manifest. But by the Spirit of God, he lived out an obedient life so that we have hope. He was sanctified, set apart, so that we could also be sanctified and walk in his steps. So kind would reproduce kind. Now, it's not our ability, because when a tree grows, what does it do? It produces that which is in the seed. It produces, well, the fruit of the gospel, isn't it? That seed goes into the ground, good ground, and it comes up, bears forth fruit, 30, 60, and 100 fold. It reproduces itself. Healthy sheep reproduce. That's what happens. How about Colossians chapter 1, verse 19? For it pleased the Father that in him, what? All the fullness should dwell. So there's no lack in the Lord Jesus. It's all the fullness. And that's being now made manifest, actually, not only there, but in chapter 2 and verse 9 of Colossians as well. It says the same thing, that the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in him. This is who he is, but it's being made manifest. What's he reproducing then in the life of someone who knows him? That same fullness, isn't it? That we would be filled with all the fullness of God, Ephesians chapter 3. That's his design. Kind produces kind. So Jesus says in John 14 and verse 9, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. It's being made manifest. Colossians 1 and verse 15. Verse 15, yeah, there we go. He is the what? Image of God. And what was Adam created as? Man. See, what you have is you have people that will turn and say, well, no, you're forgiven, that's all you are. That's not what the Bible teaches, is it? Be careful, because what they do is they lull someone who might be coming into the kingdom back to sleep again. They come and lead them away as false teachers who will tell them other things so that they never really produce the fruit of the kingdom. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. There needs to be a reproducing in the life of the believer. It's evidence of whom they belong to, who their Father is. Jesus says the same kinds of things when it comes to it. He says there, like we read in Matthew 13, verse 38, that these were sons of the wicked one. Notice, turn with me to John 8. Verse 42, and we'll read down from there. Jesus is now interacting with a group of people, a group of Jews. They're arguing with Jesus about who he is and who they belong to. Jesus said to them, if God were your Father, you would love me, for I proceed forth and came from God. Actually, let's back up again. Back up to verse 39, please, Doug. Sorry. They answered and said to him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the what? Well, the same works would be reproduced in you. Kind would produce kind. Elsewhere, he says, Abraham saw my day and rejoiced. So works of faith would be produced in the life of someone who was a son of Abraham. The Bible says that when we're born again, we become sons of Abraham through the Lord Jesus Christ and the work of his Spirit within, Galatians chapter 3 and chapter 4. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I heard from God. Abraham did not do this. So what's in their heart? Murder. That's what's in their heart. So he's saying, listen, that's not who your father is, because that's not the way Abraham was. And he'll go on further in this. You do the deeds of your father. When they said to him, we were not born of fornication, meaning we're not born outside of marriage, outside of a true relationship. We have one father, God. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would what? Love me. So we have both. Now, who is Abraham's God? It's the true God. And so he's producing in him those characteristics of faith and trust, walking with God. He was God's friend, it says. And then if God was their father, they would love the Lord Jesus. So faith and love would be produced, wouldn't it? Not murder, not rejecting of the truth. It begins to show the quality of heart, doesn't it? Now, you can't tell necessarily the wheat and the tares until the time, because as growing up, they seem look the same. One's poisonous, one's life, one's bread and food, and the other death. All planted in the same world. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I proceed forth and came from God, nor have I come of myself, but he sent me. Going, why do you not understand my speech? Because you are not able to listen to my word. You are of your father, the devil. And the desires of your father you want to do. Why? Kind is producing kind. That's what happens. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie. He speaks from his own resources. Other translations say he speaks his own native tongue, his own language, and lies. For he is a liar and the father of it. So what will he reproduce? Well, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He's the father of lies. What will he reproduce in his own children? Lies. There will be a lying people, deceptive people, a pretending people, an outward appearance oriented people. In fact, what do we see in the world? Image is what? Everything. They have no problem. They've advertised that. Image is everything. Image is nothing. Glory is everything. And that's the substance of God in the heart of the believer, producing the image and glory of God, not just outward, but inward, shining forth, just like Jesus. Two different camps, two different categories. See, now all of a sudden the delineation becomes a lot clearer, doesn't it? It's no longer, ooh, who's what and what's what. In fact, there was a particular man, Acts 13, verse 10 specifically, but this guy thought he could purchase the gift of laying on hands so that people could receive the Holy Spirit. He wanted to buy it from the Apostle Peter. He thought that with his money, he could purchase a gift from God. Why would he think that? Why would he want to do that? Why would that be in his heart, not to become what God wants him to become and let the life of God flow, but he's wanting, I want it for myself so that he could bring what? Glory and honor to what? Himself. Peter turns to him and look what he says. He says, oh, full of all deceit, all fraud, you son of the dude. That's pretty intense. Because there was a fraud to him. It was a fakeness. He was wanting something that wasn't actually given to him. But he was wanting it for what? His own glory. Peter's really strong. Because in the midst of it, it seemed like the man had come to faith. He was hanging out with all the other Christians and saw them doing it. He was marveling at the miracles being done. He wanted what they had, but he didn't want Jesus. The Pharisees, Jesus speaks of in the same way. Matthew 23, in the last week of Jesus, he's has manifested his glory the whole time, and they're calling him demon-possessed. They're saying that he's of the devil. But Jesus, with his correct, righteous judgment, verse 23, or chapter 23 of Matthew, specifically verse 15, he explains, this is what you are. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Actually, hypocrite means play actor. That's just what it means. You know, when someone was, you know, when you act on stage, you pretend to be someone that you're not. You're taking on a different character. That's the word that's used. It's a play actor. But when it comes to the things of God, what you are on the outside is not what you are on the inside. Then what are you on the inside? Well, Jesus says to them, he says, for you travel land and sea to win one proselyte. And when he is won, a proselyte is someone that they convert to their way of doing things. And when you, and when he has been won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourself. So in other words, he's saying, not only are you a son of hell, but you make those then who follow you twice as much as what you are. The tear planted by the wicked one, as opposed to the sons of the kingdom. See, the Lord Jesus, when he came into the world, he came to give life and to give it more abundantly, that there would be a reproduction of the life of God in the lives of humanity, of those who've come to faith in him. They're born again out of one grouping, out from under Adam, it says in Romans 5, and out of his genealogy, being that which was formed in him, the enemy reproducing his character in Adam. And we're born again, as it were, we die and we're raised in newness of life. In fact, in Romans 8 and verse 29, it says that God is conforming us to the image of Christ, but it's for a specific reason. Conformed to the image of his son, that he might be what? The firstborn among many brethren, ones like him. That's amazing hope, isn't it? That through faith in him, he'll translate his character into you and enable you to walk in grace and walk in love and walk in holiness and walk in righteousness and to produce the very characteristics of Jesus. That's his goal. That's his predestined purpose for you, that you be the firstborn among many brethren, those who put their faith in Christ. That there would be, like I said earlier, the works of Abraham. That's faith, the love of God, you'd love Jesus. In fact, it goes on to say, even in Hebrews chapter 2, beginning with verse 11, that this is why Jesus came, and that he's not actually ashamed to call you brethren. That he's not ashamed of those who put their trust in him. He's not cringing at the fact that you belong to his family. We can do that, can't we? We have like family reunions, and then there's always the old uncle, whoever, that's like embarrasses everyone, you know? Or there's Auntie so-and-so that just can't hold her liquor and she's just all over the place dancing on the tables. And then you get all those funny videos, don't you, of fails, as they say. But Jesus isn't looking at us that way. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified, purified, are all one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren. Keep going, saying, I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praise to you. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here am I and the children whom God has given me. Reproduced life, kind producing kind. How serious is this? When I was an early believer and I was asking these kinds of questions personally, because I was seeing people who were really godly and thinking, I was comparing myself to them and thinking, Lord, I'm not where they're at. And I began to ask very real questions. And I've shared this before at different points, but there are those that they use the term nominal Christian was the term that I heard. A Christian, somebody who is in Christian as a name only. On Sunday, they were a Christian. The rest of the week, they lived like the devil. And that's not what being a Christian is. Praising God with their mouth and cursing their brother or sister. But there was those who thought they were Christian is what I was told, but they weren't really. So that the tares thought they were really wheat. Dude, that freaked me out. Because if that's in my head and I think I am, how could I think differently than what I really am and what I think? Does that make sense? If I think I am, then I think I am. So how do you get free from that thought? If I think I am and I'm not really, or if I think I am and I really am, how can I discern between the two? Fair? Well, I struggled through that. I worked through that because I had to know, because I didn't want to base my life on a lie. If I'm going to have the real thing, I wanted the real thing. I didn't want a halfway point. I didn't want something that was a delusion. I wanted the real thing, and I had to know. And boy, I tell you, nights spent awake praying and interceding, the amount of fasting I was doing, I tell you, it really, I went through the mill trying to understand. God brought me back to the cross, really. I've shared that with you at different points. But can I give you just a couple of things that, because tonight, the possibility that those some hear that you're a tare and not a wheat is real. If you look at the four soils that are mentioned in the parable of the sower, it was only one out of the four that were actually genuine reproducing, wasn't it? So if we take that on a percentage, only one in four are genuine. That's pretty freaked out. And it's possible tonight you're watching online and you're going, well, I've done this. How do I know if I really am? How can I know? Can I just give you a couple of indicators? The question yourself. So how do I get out of my own thinking? I've got to compare my thinking with what God says. Because I know God always speaks the truth. And the evidence of what he says will be reproduced in the life of the believer. I can know that if it matches what he said, not by my works, but I'm testing my own heart, as it were. The Apostle Paul told the church in Galatians, check yourselves to see if you're really in the faith. So that you're not playing a game. Because listen, saints, listen, and those, everyone, it's not worth going to the window, as it were, and breathing heavy, wanting to have the taste of everything that's being provided, but not going in through the door. There's no point being that close to reality and perishing. There isn't. Because there are those that build foundations, but Jesus put it this way, that some build it on rock and stone and a foundation that's going to last and a foundation of sand. There are those who come to Jesus, if I can put it that way in inverted commas, they want forgiveness without repentance. They want to say, I'm forgiven, but they want to continue to go their own way. That's not the faith. They want salvation without surrender to the Lordship of Jesus. It doesn't work. The first one I want to ask you, and these are serious questions for our hearts. The first one is reservation and yielding to Christ. Is there reservation in your heart? Is there an unwillingness to yield yourself to him? Is there an unwillingness to yield yourself to Jesus? Do you find when his command comes that you're like, no, I'll do what I want, when I want, how I want, and there's no, don't tell me what to do. I've seen it. Even those who would claim to belong to Jesus, I've seen them do it. I'm like, dude, that frightens me. It really does. Not them, but what I'm seeing frightens me. Is there an irritation in your heart when his commands come? Do you find there's a resistance when His Word comes to your heart? And I was told a long time ago by an old saint. He said to me, he said, if you throw a rock into a group of dogs, the one that yelps is the one that God hit. And the word goes out, there's a reaction. I've learned that people will deny the fact of what's going on in the reaction, but they react. It reveals what's in the heart. And that's not to condemn. But you don't want to get to the throne of God and say, yeah, but I thought I really was. I thought I was genuinely okay with you. Because then there's no hope anymore, is there? Then it really is too late. Then that's got to be the most frightening moment in anyone's existence. And they would have wished I would have never been born rather than to come under the wrath justly. Because there won't be any more excuses. It won't be like, well, yeah, but, God will open it all up. And we'll, even for our own selves, our own conscience will bear witness. And we're like, nope, yep, oh, yeah, I did that. And the mouths will go quiet. And everyone will know. Because of who God is. God's so good. He hates everything evil. And He wants us to enter into that life with Him, that relationship with Him. Does it bother you that the Bible is restrictive? And when God says no, He means no. If He says yes, you need to do that, it says yes. Do we find ourselves wanting to make excuses and reasons and arguments and roundabouts and loopholes? And that's dangerous in the heart, saints. Jesus said to me, those who come to me, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, enters the kingdom. You want to find yourself inwardly, maybe you won't do it outwardly, but inside you're saying, no, no, no. Secondly, in what you do for Jesus, if I can put it that way, is it the love of Christ that's actually compelling you? Is it something in your heart that I love Him, that's why I want to obey Him? Because then the opinions of men fall flat. They just don't hold the weight that they used to, because you love Him more than the praise of men. Are you compelled by the love of Christ, the desire for His glory? See, that's what we were created for, isn't it? We weren't created for ourselves. We were created for eternal glory. Actually, the Bible says that we would be ones to shine eternally in that glory. But that's His glory, not ours. We didn't earn it. He's bestowed it upon us, compelled by the love of Christ and a desire for His glory. That you love Him. You're not obeying because of fear. And I know people say this, you know, religion, oh, it just causes fear in people, and they'll try to make them obey, and that Jesus didn't work that way. He said, if you love me, you will obey me. There's a relationship with Him because He died for us. He gave His life for us. And when that clicks, our hearts are changed. But we love Him. It's not out of fear. It's not out of law. It's not out of I have to. And it's for glory, His glory, not for self-seeking. Well, I want to make myself important. Some people think that's what the church is for. Some people look for importance in the world, can't find it, so they become gospel singers. They do. That's what happens. Because they think that they can get fame through the church, because sometimes we're gullible. And we think that when people are standing up there singing and dancing and praising, that they're really praising Jesus, but really they're wanting what? Glory. Be clear. There's all sorts of awards in the States, one called the Dove Awards, where they honor all sorts of kinds of people. There was a guy named Keith Green once, my goodness, in the middle of it, because he stood up and, oh, he hated it. And he didn't charge for any of his albums. If you wanted his album, you could have it for free. If you couldn't afford it, if you could, because it helped him produce the other ones. But if you couldn't afford it, you just write, he'd send you free ones. And he's sitting in the Dove Awards, and these people are giving out. I think it was a Dove. It might have been the Grammy. But they were, no, Dove, D-O-V-E, Dove. No, not the Devil Award, sorry, my accent, sorry. No, the Dove, D-O-V-E, it's a Christian kind of grouping on things.
and where they have all these singers come. And he stood up in there and called them prophets for hire. Because all you're doing is looking to make money rather than glorifying Jesus. What's in your heart? So reservation, the yielding to Christ, the love of Christ and for his glory that compels you. Is there self-righteousness in you? See, I've heard people say, you know, well, Christians are self-righteous. Our genuine believer is not self-righteous. They have the righteousness of Christ. It does bring a boldness and a freedom, but there's no self-righteousness. Are you depending on your righteousness? Do you think that you can earn your way to heaven? Do you think that there's something that you can do to add to the gospel that's your part you have to play? Hear me. Do you think that for yourself that, you know, Jesus did this, this, and this, and maybe you believe the cross and the resurrection, but then there's this thought in your heart, but I did this. And I'm doing this. It's a small part to contribute to your salvation. Then you're basing your foundations on sand. And it won't uphold. Let the word search your heart. Because in our minds, we think a certain way, I know. But then the word of God comes like light and shines on us. And it either there's a justification in Christ, or there's an acquittal that happens there, or it brings about the conviction that it needs to bring. Because if you're not, you need to be born again. You need to put your trust in Christ and Him alone. First John in chapter 2, verse 15 says, love not the world or anything in the world. Because if you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. You say, well, I don't love the world. I just like to be around it. I like the atmosphere of it. I like to be as close to it as I can without getting in trouble. You know what I mean? That's loving the world. If that's your heart, if you still like Friday nights down at the pub, there's a problem. You say, well, yeah, but Jesus drank, he had parties, you know, he went. Yeah, he went and he spoke life. And they repented and people's hearts changed. He didn't go because he liked the atmosphere. He wasn't a party dude. Oh, he loved people by all means and he went where they were. But he went with the gospel, with the power to transform life. He loved the world. Is there pride? The reason I ask pride is because pride is really the opposite of righteousness that's given and grace that's given. Because when you realize that what he's given is a gift, then there's no pride. You're not boasting in anything you've done. It really brings humility. In fact, grace and humility are two sides of the same coin. You find a proud Christian, there's something majorly wrong, and the possibility that they're just a tear is very real. They want to boast in themselves and not boast in Christ. Now, we give testimony of what he's done. We want to bring glory and honor to whom? And that's in our heart. We're not using his name to bring us glory. You say it, it's all about me. Look at me. That's very dangerous. Number 6, do you love pleasure more than you love him? It says in the latter days, that's what's going to happen. Are you willing to forsake some things to honor him, which in the world you found pleasurable? The Bible says that sin is pleasurable, but it's only for a season. In the end, it brings death. What holds the highest sway? We might say it, my happiness.
Is your happiness the uttermost part of your life? That's your pinnacle. That's what you really want above everything else. If God's in it, great. If he's not, no problem, because your happiness is the most important thing to you. Maybe our jobs, our families, our sleeping around, it could be our religion, it could be all sorts of things. But that's my life. That's what I'm for. That's what I'm about. We live for pleasure rather than living for him. My happiness is the utmost important. That living that way is actually the basis of what they call humanism. Unfortunately, in our day, they've tried to take that and combined it with Christianity, where we become the center of the universe and God's for us and everything's about us. And it's not. It's really all about him. And that's who we were created for. And when we fulfill that in him, we're at our best. That's when we portray real love. That's when we're sacrificial. That's when God's receiving glory. That's when the lives around us of people that are changed, and then something about what's happening in us can be reproduced in others because of his spirit at work. Some 30, 60, even 100-fold. They're sons of the kingdom, and they're sons of the wicked one. This is why Jesus, when he was preaching, went around and said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's drawn near to you. Come into it," he's saying. Turn from where you're headed and where you're at, where you're planted. Come into the kingdom. Receive the forgiveness because of his mercy. Turn to him and let him make you clean. Surrender to him. Let him be your Lord. And he'll collect you up, you're his. And he'll replant his very life. The resurrection life of Jesus is replanted in you. It's life. This is a sobering message. I know, saints. But when you know, you know. Yeah? And there's no point getting to the gates, as it were, and finding yourself turned away, but you really thought you were going in. It isn't about how much money you give in the offering. It isn't about all the promises we can make and all the trying to change. It's really casting yourself wholeheartedly with everything you are on Christ and letting him reproduce his life in you. A good tree bears good fruit. And God wants you to be his trees so that he can bear forth good fruit in you. Lord, help us. Father, we just recognize that this is a sobering message. We recognize that it's your desire for us to reproduce that which was in Christ. And Lord, it's by your Spirit and by your grace and by your working in us that we would manifest the love of Jesus Christ. And we recognize too, Father, that there's lots of people around us who make lots of excuses for us. If we're not walking the way we ought, oh, we're just human, oh, we're just this. And Lord, we recognize that those words, that wisdom is not from you. For you have called us to walk in light as you are in the light. And those who walk in the light, there is no cause of stumbling, for stumbling in them. And that we would know what it means to have fellowship with you in truth and know the blood of Jesus constantly cleansing. For in your light we see light. We understand what truth is. We understand what it is that you're calling us to. And so, Lord, shine your light in the way that you do, which is gracious. We pray for those that are here tonight, and we pray for those that are watching online. And we just thank you, Lord, that no matter how far we've gone, that your desire is to bring us to yourself. That you're the one that delivers from evil things, even evil thoughts, even our own hearts, and gives us a new heart that we want to, and we find ourselves being able to follow. We pray, Lord, as we look to the cross, we look at what your word says about what it means to belong to you, that the clarity, the assurance that comes by your Spirit, that we're yours, or the conviction that comes by your Spirit that we're not. For both of those, we want to say thank you, because you could leave us as we are. But your desire is to make things clear. that we may come and run to you and find, as we were looking at earlier, that you are merciful and gracious, you are slow to anger, you are abound in loving kindness. Oh, and you forgive. And so we pray for help tonight. We pray for help for those here, for those watching online, and anyone who will watch even later on. Lord, you're the God who knows all things, and time is not an issue for you, so bless them. And may they know that assurance that comes from you, that they're yours, your Spirit testifying with theirs, their sons, and then the light of the character of Christ being made manifest. So we ask your blessing this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you for listening. Please feel free to share this message with others, but we ask that you do not charge for or alter the content without permission. For more information, messages, and contact details, please go to www.newhopecc.co.uk or download our app off the Apple and Android stores.